You've just seen some pictures of McIntosh. Now I'd like to show you McIntosh in person. But today, for the first time ever, I'd like to let McIntosh speak for itself.
Hello, I am McIntosh. It sure is great to get out of that bag. And accustomed as I am to public speaking, I'd like to share with you a maxim I thought of the first time I met an IBM mainframe. Never trust a computer you can't lift. Obviously, I can talk, but right now, I'd like to sit back and listen. So it is with considerable pride that I introduce a man who's been like a father to me, Steve Jobs.
I want my belief reinforced that the Macintosh platform is not just relevant in today's marketplace, but the leading edge of technology. And to start us off in the right direction is an individual who really needs little introduction. So please join with me now and welcome, from Apple Computer, Steve Jobs.
Yeah, he's a fascinating bundle of contradictions. So influential, yet so secretive. He's incomparable. There's no one like him.
Apple's not relevant, as relevant as it used to be everywhere, but in some incredibly important market segments, it's extraordinarily relevant.
A very remarkable man, extremely smart, spellbinding, mesmerizing leader of people.
The ability of the organization to execute is really high, though. I mean, I've met some extraordinary people at Apple. There's a lot of great people at Apple. They're doing some of the wrong things because the plan has been wrong. And lastly, what I found is rather than anarchy, I found people that can't wait to fall into line behind a good strategy. There just hasn't been one. We've got a great relationship with Intel. And both companies are engineering driven, and they both love to challenge each other. And Intel's got enormous amounts of technology. And so when we were building this product, we asked them to consider something. This is their amazing Core 2 Duo chip, right? It's a screamer. We said, we want that chip in this product, but we need to go to smaller packaging, the same die on a smaller package. It sounds easy, it's not. They spent a lot of, invested a lot of engineering to create this for us. This is the same chip in a package that is 60% smaller. And it's one of the reasons we could build MacBook Air. And so I'd like to say thank you to Intel. And it's my pleasure to invite the CEO of Intel, Paul Otellini, on stage. I'd like to give him a round of applause.
Hi, Steve. You know, Steve, about a year ago, you asked us to challenge us to try and get the world's best microprocessor into this impossibly thin machine. I brought one with us today. When we started this project, we didn't think it was possible. The product that we ended up building for you is about the width of a dime. It's as thick as a nickel. It has 400 million really fast, really power-efficient transistors on it, and it's state-of-the-art. And I think just working with you and your team to produce these wonderful devices has been a challenge, There are times when we sweated over it, but at the end of the day, we did what we do best together, which is innovate.
Yep.
And I want to thank you and your team for allowing us the opportunity to innovate with you.
Well, thank you.
Let me give you this as a souvenir.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you. Woo! This is awesome technology. Thank you, Paul. Thank you, Intel. It's so thin, it even fits inside.
You just want to believe everything the man says. It's an incredible talent he has for getting people to hear what he says and get excited about it.
The reality distortion field is when he's in this sort of Svengali role where he says, and it only costs $1,800, and people applaud. And when they get home, they say, yeah, but the computer that I have now costs $900. Why is it good that it only costs $1,800? And worse still, why did I buy one on the way out?
This is the new MacBook Air, and you can get a feel for how thin it is. Yeah, there it is. Look at this. Amazing product here. Full-size keyboard, full-size display.
If you're an Apple product manager and Steve is going to introduce your products, the prior 3 months to that day, your life is hell. And you know it's only going to be 10 seconds. But that 10 seconds, you're going to pay. You're going to sweat blood for those 10 seconds.
Every once in a while, a revolutionary product comes along that changes everything.
He's a showman who can really introduce a product. And he has great products to introduce. You can be a great showman and have a piece of crap and fail. You could also have a great product and be a lousy show person and also fail. He's both. He's got the engineering behind him and he's got the ability to do it.
He introduced a few of these into the world. In 1984, we introduced the Macintosh. It didn't just change Apple, it changed the whole computer industry. In 2001, we introduced the first iPod. And it didn't just change the way we all listen to music. It changed the entire music industry. Well, today, we're introducing three revolutionary products. The first one is a widescreen iPod with touch controls. The second is a revolutionary mobile phone. And the third is a breakthrough internet communications device. So, three things: a widescreen iPod with touch controls, a revolutionary mobile phone, and a breakthrough internet communications device. An iPod, a phone, and an internet communicator. An iPod. A phone. Are you getting it? These are not three separate devices. This is one device. And we are calling it iPhone. Today, Apple is going to reinvent the phone. Here it is. I can tell you what our goal is. Our goal is to make the best personal computers in the world and to make products we are proud to sell and would recommend to our family and friends. And we want to do that at the lowest prices we can. But I have to tell you, there's some stuff in our industry that we wouldn't be proud to ship, that we wouldn't be proud to recommend to our family and friends. And we can't do it. We just can't ship junk. So there are thresholds that we can't cross because of who we are. Because our products are usually not premium priced. You go and price out our competitors' products, and you add the features that you have to add to make them useful, and you'll find in some cases they are more expensive than our products. The difference is we don't offer stripped down, lousy products. You know, we just don't offer categories of products like that. But if you move those aside and compare us with our competitors, I think we compare pretty favorably. And a lot of people have been doing that and saying that now for the last 18 months.
The MacBook Pro family really is a quite remarkable engineering achievement. It's truly the result of years of hard work, of innovation, I think driven by this obsessive attention to every detail. And this is particularly evident in the enclosure. I mean, traditionally, notebooks are made from multiple parts. But the problem is when you have multiple parts, you add size and weight, and you increase the opportunity for failure. And the huge breakthrough that we had was to replace all of those parts with just one part. And that one part we called the unibody. We figured out a way of being able to make the notebook fundamentally thinner, lighter, more robust, and with sort of a degree of fit and finish that we've never even dreamed of before. And the only way to make that one part was to machine it from a single piece of aluminium.
And the question has arisen lately, is there room for a third category of device in the middle? Something that's between a laptop and a smartphone. And of course, we've pondered this question for years as well.
One of the challenges of understanding Steve Jobs is that he has a different operating system from mere mortals. So mere mortals trying to understand what goes on in Steve Jobs' brain, it would be like explaining to a fish what it is to fly.
Better than the laptop, better than the smartphone. What kind of tasks? Well, things like browsing the web. That's a pretty tall order. Something that's better at browsing the web than a laptop? Okay. Doing email. Enjoying and sharing photographs. Video, watching videos. Enjoying your music collection. Playing games. Reading ebooks. If there's going to be a third category of device, it's going to have to be better at these kinds of tasks than a laptop or a smartphone. Otherwise, it has no reason for being. Now, some people have thought that that's a netbook. The problem is, netbooks aren't better at anything. They're slow, they have low quality displays, and they run clunky old PC software. So they're not better than a laptop at anything, they're just cheaper. They're just cheap laptops. And we don't think that they're a third category device. But we think we've got something that is.